I'm here standing in line, and it's 1:15, and there's two lines. There's another line for tickets after the first showing, and I just can't understand what people are standing in line for if they're not going to see the first show.
Tickets go on sale in 5 minutes. Don't worry about it.
I've never experienced anything like this before in my life, and I don't think I ever will again. And that's why I'm here. It's just I had to be able to say that I was here.
1,200 tickets, please. Just two.
I'm a medical student. You know, I should be in bed, waking up, going to class this morning. But, you know, I'm dedicated. I want to see it. You know, I took it upon myself to be here all night, skip class today, you know, just to get tickets. Because, I mean, it means more to be there the first night. Saturday, Sunday, next week, it won't be the same.
How freaky can I sound? I believe in Star Wars completely. I believe in it in the same way people believe in myths. Like, it didn't... I don't believe that it actually happened, but I believe that it's, I believe in it as a religious statement and as a parable of something that could have happened in a society that may well have once structured itself around something called the Force. It's the only thing I've ever seen that makes me completely believe it. I mean, I've dismissed the religions that I grew up with, and I ended up with Star Wars.
Well, the Force is actually, it penetrates us and binds us. It brings all living things together, and it's here, man. I mean, look at this. This is the Force.
You know, it's got all the elements of classical fairy tales or mythology. And so, you know, just like all the old fairy tales and myths used to be, everybody finds a place in it, and this is our postmodern fairy tale, and, you know, they all need something to cling on to, so that's why they're here.
The thing that differentiates from Star Trek is that Trekkies, as well, I'm not saying every Trekkie, but a lot of Trekkies live for Star Trek, but everyone can take Star Wars with a pinch of salt, and it's just good fun, that's all.
My name is Leia, and I have homeschooling, and I'm in process of writing a book.
And you came here on opening day. You're seeing the first show here at Johnson Theater.
Yes, all other appointments were canceled just to make sure that we were here. It took her about a year to write her book. She started when she was 11. She's created new worlds and new people.
New characters.
New worlds, all that to coincide with the Star Wars theme.
You should see my room. I have nothing but Star Wars books to do research on. So I have enough research, you could say, to actually be George Lucas. And that's our next step.
You know, George Lucas wasn't satisfied. He took Star Wars from what was the best in 1977 to what is the best now in 1997.
But it's like colorizing Casablanca or something, you know? Do you really want to do that?
I don't think it's that.
They made a great film in
77.
They made a great film in 77. Well, it's like changing a classic film. They made a great film.
As far as I know, he was sick of it. But for his fans, he went out of his way to do it for us.
This is my great fear. I have this great fear that George is gonna die before he makes the 9th movie. Like, he's gonna make 8, right? And then 9, he's just gonna kick the bucket. And we were talking about this yesterday. There's all these things that have happened. Like, I think Beethoven died after the 9th symphony. And this guy knows this theory of nines or something, where all these people have died before their 9th whatever, their 9th thing. And there's 9 movies to Star Wars. And George might kick it. That would suck. I wouldn't know what happened in the end. Doesn't that frighten you in any way?
I think the most outrageous thing I've done is come out of a warm house, you know, with the idea that I would get a ticket, you know, within 45 minutes of starting time.
Hey, do you have any Star Wars fantasies?
Princess Leia.
Help me, Obi-Wan. You're my only hope. Help me, Obi-Wan. You're my only hope.
It's actually one of the films, one of the few films that makes me want to belong within the story. And I think that's what makes a top-notch film.
You know, there were always the rumors of the prequels years and years ago, and I thought how cool it would be, you know, if they used me as the young Luke Skywalker, you know. Every preteen's dream.
I wanted to be Luke so bad that I wanted to dye my hair, but Mom didn't.
going for that one.
And then you get older, and then you get hard, and you think, oh no, I wanted to be like Han, you know?
Basically, I can't imagine a world where Star Wars didn't exist. You know, it's like, I honestly think, I can't think of a way, say, Ronald Reagan influenced my life the way, say, something Star Wars did, like Star Wars did.
The Strategic Defense Initiative has been labeled Star Wars, but it isn't about war. It's about peace. And in that struggle, if you'll pardon my stealing a film line, the Force is with us.
I was like little, and he started calling everything Star Wars. I thought that, that the government was like actually gonna go try and find Chewbacca or something like that. It was very confusing. Now it's all passe. I guess, did they ever do it? Did they make it? Like, I thought it sounded cool at the time. It was like gonna be missiles in space and like shit like that, but.
The biggest influence it had on me was when I was like 19 or 18 years old, before I was legal, going to bars, I always tried to do the Jedi mind trick. There's a point in Star Wars, they get stopped by the stormtroopers and say, we need to see your identification. Obi-Wan Kenobi goes, you don't need to see our identification. And I always try that.
I think I left my ID in my other pants. Look, we're in kind of a hurry.
These aren't the drones you want.
These aren't the drones we want.
You don't want to detain us.
We don't want to detain you.
And you know what? Only one time did somebody actually know what I was doing. They were as big a dork as I was, and they actually knew what I was saying. And
so did they let you in?
No.
I have Star Wars paraphernalia because my friend brought it with me so that we could play with it for a while. Sure. It's the Millennium Falcon, yeah. Apparently it has a ripcord to it, and if you put it on a table with the ripcord, it would spin around, but we don't have that part.
I used to have an R2-D2 original cookie jar, but I have three cats and they knocked it off the shelf, which is pretty sad.
Yeah, I've got the old Death Star set up with the paper sides and the plastic turbo lift.
I had the Planet Hoth, had all the action figures. I think my neighbor stole it. It's still a controversy in my family. So subsequently, I've been purchasing anything I can get on my hands on Star Wars, and I've never opened it out of the box. I still have everything. It's just completely in its box. I don't know how
the box alone is worth $150.
I got the videos in pan and scan versions, widescreen versions, THX versions, Laserdisc versions, TV version, which had different takes in it.
This is Luke Skywalker's jacket from the Empire Strikes Back, and it cost a lot. But the great thing is that it's actually a nice jacket, and my girlfriend still doesn't know that it's a Star Wars related item, so I could keep,
Oh, the posters. Oh man, I got the posters framed on a dry mount. Uh-huh. With black metal frame with glass. It's uh-huh. Amazing.
Have you ever dressed up as a Star Wars character?
No, I mean, I'm not like one of those weird Trekkie guys that comes
in. No, for Halloween or something.
No.
When I was a kid, I used to go into Newberry's and steal all the action figures back in New Jersey. And I used to go back the next day and steal all the weapons that I missed. And I used to stuff them in my socks. I used to stuff them. I know it's very unbefitting of, a Jedi Knight to do something like that, but, that's probably the craziest thing I've done, was rip off Star Wars figures. I'm sorry, George Lucas, I didn't mean to, bust into your profits, but, dude, I needed Luke with the green lightsaber.
I can't choose, so I wore them both, that was the best thing I could figure out.
Okay, there's that Chewbacca guy, and you probably see him.
He's right there.
Yeah, that guy. He, at some point before the movie started, just ran in front, between the front row and the theater, and everybody just started going nuts. Everybody started cheering for him.
It was screaming and screaming, and then right when it was about to begin, it stopped. It complete silence. And then when it started, the crowd just went crazy.
So my theory is, if you're old enough to have seen Star Wars in the theaters and you went, then you're Generation X. But if you didn't go, if you weren't old enough to go, if you weren't born yet, you're not in my generation. Because I can't communicate with somebody that doesn't know who the hell Darth Vader is.
I was 4 years old and everybody laughs at me. They say that I don't remember, but I do.
I saw it here.
20 years ago.
When I was 3 and a half, my mom was taking me out of nursery school to go see this.
Had to wait all the way around the corner and around the side.
I kept falling asleep in the theaters before they blew up the Death Star.
I thought Star Wars, when I didn't know anything about it, I thought Star Wars was about movie stars, like Hollywood actors, bickering.
No, I mean, it was sort of complicated until I realized it was just basically good versus bad.
Instead, I went to see For the Love of Benji.
I remember that my mom took me to the first movie and she dropped me off with my movie money and she said, listen, I know you're going to worry about the robots so they don't get hurt. Have a nice time.
And the TIE fighters were good or bad, and the X-Wings were good or bad, and it was very complicated for me at first, but I'm okay now.
I just felt that in order to fulfill my destiny as a human being on this earth, I had to see it in the theater all the way through, and to make up for lost time, I'm seeing it 5 times tonight.
I got here on time, got in to see the first show, and I was blown away by it, and now, you know, now I can go on with my childhood.
You know, we've all seen it a billion times before. It's just the opportunity to sit in the theater with, you know, 1,500 freaks.
My boss I needed today off because they had all these unexpected visitors coming from out of town, and I wanted to hang out with them because they're going to be like at the airport for 2 hours, is what I told him. And then I came here, and now he's going to see this, and I'm going to be fired.